Well, we're going to be going through James chapter 3 this evening. Oh, I like Rose's picture. That's very good. That is exactly what I need to do many days right there. Duct tape, good use of it. Let's pray and we'll get started. Lord God, I just thank you for your kindness, God, that you show us each and every day, Lord. I'm just reminded of that scripture, and I try to repeat it, Lord, when I wake each morning. It says that this is the day that the Lord has made, and I will be glad and rejoice in it, Lord. Lord, and I stand on those words because some days it's a battle to repeat those words to you, Lord. Other days it's easier, but God, your goodness endures and your faithfulness endures, and we thank you, God, for your loving kindness that you show towards us. Lord God, I thank you as we get into your word this evening. I pray, Holy Spirit, that you would fall upon us, that you would anoint me, Lord, as I go through this, and just rest upon us, Lord. May your glory just rest upon us this evening. I ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, before I start, I thought I would just maybe second or just encourage you, as Ashley said, that she was working with a worship team as far as just getting a portion of scripture and then putting it to music, and how powerful that is. When I look out among the crowd, we've got some youngins over here, we got a few seasoned ones over here. There's a seasoned one raising the hand back there. But for those of us that are a little more seasoned, I grew up in the 60s and 70s, and down in LA, the big radio station was KHJ, and KHJ played your top 40 rock and roll. And every night I fell asleep listening to rock music. And, the songs that were being put into my head, I found them, later living those things out. What goes into your spirit, what goes into your head, makes a difference. It does. It makes a difference. And if you're committing God's word to memory, if you're committing God's word through song into your spirit, those things, what you're sowing in, you'll see those things coming back out. So I just encourage you. She's talking to the worship team about those things, but that's really a good discipline, just to put the word of God to song. I remember songs much easier than I do. You give me a scripture on a 3x5 card, my brain doesn't work that way. Put it to song, all of a sudden I've got it committed to memory. I think that's what I've really loved about a smartphone, is it has Pandora, and you have all kinds of worship music. And I've never been someone who's enjoyed talking on the phone much, but I really like my Pandora. it's a great way to organize your music. So, well, we're going to go through James 3, 1 to 12 tonight, and I think as one of the things I guess I've learned kind of through stumbles and stops and starts over the years is that when I speak about something in scripture, it's much easier for me to speak about something I know. Years ago, I think as a young man, I'd hear a great sermon on the radio or hear it at church. It might be Chuck Smith, might be some other great preacher, and then I would be given an opportunity maybe in a Bible study to preach something, so I'd just try to re-preach what's already been preached. And yet, it really, God hadn't sown those things into my heart yet. And that is one of the advantages of getting older, is that, the older you live, the more things God shows you, the more things he sows into you. Both blessing and heartache, those are all things that develop us as believers, as we walk with him. So the reason I picked this tonight is because it's a struggle. For me, it's still a struggle. I think I'm sometimes frustrated, sometimes just disgusted by the fact that, I can be singing praises to God, and then the next moment, blah, 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 something comes out of my mouth that, I'm just like, whoa, where did that come from? And it's a frustration. And I think James, as we go through this tonight, and other scriptures that I'll bring in, you'll see that God doesn't just leave us at a place of desperation, like, oh, I'll never get control of my tongue, or that's just the way I am. God offers hope, and we're going to see that as we go through. So first, I'm just going to read through the verses. Chapter 3. Not many of you should presume to be teachers, my brothers, because you know that we who teach will be judged more strictly. We all stumble in many ways. If anyone is never at fault in what he says, he's a perfect man, able to keep his whole body in check. When we put bits into the mouths of horses to make them obey us, we can turn the whole animal. Or take ships as an example. Although they are so large and driven by strong winds, they are steered by a very small rudder wherever the pilot wants to go. Likewise, the tongue is a small part of the body, but it makes great boast. Consider what a great forest is set on fire by a small spark. The tongue is also a fire, a world of evil among the parts of the body. It corrupts the whole person, sets the whole course on his life on fire, and itself set on fire by hell. All kinds of animals, birds, reptiles, and creatures of the sea are being tamed and have been tamed by man. But no man can tame the tongue. It is a restless evil, full of deadly poison. With the tongue, we praise our Lord and Father, and with it we curse men who have been made in God's likeness. Out of the same mouth come praise and cursing. My brothers, this should not be. Can both fresh water and salt water flow from the same spring? My brothers, can a fig tree bear olives or a grapevine bear figs? Neither can a salt spring produce fresh water. You know, I was thinking about the tongue itself. I was thinking about how to maybe make this a little more relevant. And I was running this morning, I thought, it's interesting that we think of the tongue as a communicating tool that our body has. But when you also think of tongues, a lot of times you'll think, you'll hear people say, like a tongue almost being a language. So when we're talking about the tongue tonight, I'm not going to just restrict the tongue to the things that come out of our mouth. But I don't know about you, but I have a lot of conversations in my head. You know, I talk to myself a lot, hopefully, you know, not in a corner mumbling, but I talk to myself throughout the day, and a lot of those conversations are not uplifting. You know, and like I said, sometimes I'll be in a situation, might even be at church, you know, and all of a sudden I'm enjoying praise and worship, and I look over and something, you know, triggers me, and I have a thought that's like a conversation in my head, and I'm like, God, you know, that is not of you. And I have to take that thought captive. I think that's one of the powers we have as a believer. As the Holy Spirit indwells us, we actually do have the ability to take every thought captive. Every thought. You know, a lot of times we say, well, we're only going to give God these thoughts and we're going to keep these to ourselves. But those thoughts that are not encouraging, those thoughts that are not uplifting, those thoughts that are not adding to the kingdom of God are things that are from the pit of hell. Those are things that have to be captive and have to be put aside. I think a lot of the conversations that we have, you know, I think as a believer, I've been a Christian for a long time, and I think there's victories that I've had and yet struggles that I still have, and I think probably most of us would say that in different areas of our life. And you know, some of the conversations, I talk about outward conversations, but some of the conversations that I have in my mind are lies, you know? And as one, just for an example, a lot of times it's like, I'll say things about myself like, I can't do that, you know, or I won't do that, or I'm always this. And, you know, your mind gets going, and what's happening is you're allowing the enemy to come in and take a portion of ground that's not his. You know, we are bought by the blood of Jesus Christ. We're his. And the enemy really has no right at all to have anything, any ownership in us. We are owned by Jesus Christ. Yet sometimes we allow Satan to come in those areas. You know, what does Jesus see us? I mean, a lot of times I'll be beaten up on myself saying I'm this and I'm that. You know, but Jesus, what does he call us? He calls us a friend. He calls us his perfect creation. He calls us, you know, he calls us by loving names, not names that we might name ourselves. So part of the battle with the tongue in my case is just repeating back to God who he says I am, not who the enemy might say I am. So I'm just going to go verse by verse. I'm going to go through each one and just make some commentary on each one and some scriptures that I brought in this evening, which hopefully will pop up here. Verse 1 says, "Not many of you should presume to be teachers, my brothers, because you know that we teach. Those who teach will be judged more strictly." In case I missed my responsibility, God reminded me right off the bat what I'm called to here when I present James. As a teacher, it's certainly nothing to be frightened of if you bring the Word of God in a Bible study, or whether you stand here or stand before your friends and talk. But we need to carefully present the Word of God. We don't want to do it haphazardly. We don't want to come into it with, wasting our time doing something that's not beneficial to the kingdom of God. We want to be prepared. And I think sometimes people see this and become very intimidated, like, well, I'll never want to be a teacher because what if, I get before God and he's going to remember all these things. But, it's not something to make us fearful. It's just something to say, Lord, help me, anoint me, empower me to bring your word. So the rest of the scriptures we go through are really more specific on the tongue. So the second part, verse 2, it says, "We all stumble in many ways. If anyone is never at fault in what he says, he is a perfect man." I think one of the first scriptures I learned as a believer, Romans 3:23. Everybody pretty much know that one? "For we have all and fallen short of the glory of God." Probably the first things that we learned. And I think during my day, I'm just thinking about today. I'm thinking, have I fallen short today? I'm like, yes, I have. Have I fallen short? Maybe, did I do good maybe from 12 to 3? No, there was a couple things there that even still I fell short. And, we always fall short of the glory of God. The good news is we have a Savior. We have a Savior who says, I paid for those sins and you can be redeemed. You can be free to walk in me as you confess your sins before me. I guess, the ultimate thing is that we need a Savior. We need to know every single day we need a Savior. The only way I can ever control my tongue is through Jesus Christ and asking him to help me do that. So let's see what else it says here in this verse. It says, "He is a perfect man." It says, "If anyone is never at fault in what he says, he's a perfect man, able to keep his whole body in check." Obviously, we're never going to achieve perfection here on this earth. It's not ever going to happen where I'll finally wake up one day, roll over, in bed and Kathy and say, yeah, I got it. Yesterday, it just came to me. I finally am walking in perfection. And she will giggle and say, try again, So, at the same time, however, we don't want to just say, well, I'll never be perfect. So therefore, I'm just going to live however. That is definitely against what Scripture commands us to do. So as a believer, it's sort of a contest. We're always looking towards the perfection. We're moving towards that perfection, realizing we're going to stumble, we're going to fall. But as a believer, we are to keep our eyes fixed on him so that we move towards that area of perfection. And, I thought about this in terms of athletics, is that, it says in the perfect, after it says perfect man, it says able to keep his whole body in check. As we trust God to deliver us from our sin, as we trust God to empower us to live this life that is God's given us here in his book, it's like, excuse me, it's like we need to be moving towards something. And as an athlete, you see an athlete, what do? They train for a specific event. But that doesn't just mean they go out. I mean, if you're, I'll just pick running because I run. But if you pick running, you don't just one day go out and say, I'm just going to run all day and see what happens. Runners or any other athlete, they prepare in many ways. There's some side benefits to the fact that they're doing an athletic event. They may change their diet. They may sleep more. The effect is I'm becoming a better runner. But it is affecting the entire life of that particular athlete because there's some benefits. And in the same way, as we look towards Jesus and say, here's what you've set out before us, as we move towards Jesus, there's a lot of other benefits that come into our life. It's not just taming your tongue. It's it's drawing nearer to Him in relationship and intimacy. And I think that's the thing that's been the most exciting, I guess, to me in maybe the last 10 or so years, is that, like I say, I've been a Christian since I was a child, accepted the Lord when I was 9 years old. And yet there was a long period of time where I was fairly stagnant in my walk with the Lord. But as I began to trust Him and seek Him, it's like He met me over and over again. And it's like that intimacy that I have with the Lord now is so much greater than I had even just 10 years ago. And it's like, God, You're helping me to move in a direction that's healthy. You're helping me to achieve a relationship with You that's available. And I think sometimes we forget God yearns for a relationship with us. You know, He seeks us out. He wants us to be with Him, and it's available for each of us. So verse 3 says, when we put bits into the mouth of horses to make them obey, we can turn the whole animal. Or take ships as an example. Although they're so large and are driven by strong winds, they are steered by a very small rudder wherever the pilot likes to go. Well, when I was thinking about a small rudder and changing directions, years ago, I took a bunch of boys. We went up to Morro Bay, and we rented those little pedal canoes. And you could, I don't know if they were pedal canoes or paddle canoes. I don't remember which. But anyway, they had foot rudders, and that's how you steered them. Instead of, they must have been pedals, so otherwise you would have steered with oars. Anyway, we're pedaling along, and my son and his friend just thought it would be hilarious to come up behind me and flip my rudder up. So I would be going along, and I'd be, you know, working, and all of a sudden I'd start to be going this way. I'd work harder, and I just kept going this way, and then I'd hear laughing, and they'd be back there. I'm like, what? And sure enough, I turned around, and they'd flip my rudder up so I no longer could steer the boat. And they did this several times to me because I'm kind of competitive and I was trying to be out in front, and then they'd flip the rudder up and then I'd be, you know, heading over this way and everybody'd be laughing. So in the same way, if we step out of God's direction, His leading, we're like that ship, we're like my little canoe without a rudder. You know, we're going left, we're going right, we're going everywhere except where God wants us to do. Flip that little teeny rudder in the water, all of a sudden I'm, you know, a master of the canoe. You know, it made such a huge difference. And it's just an example of exactly what we can do or not do as we allow this Holy Spirit to lead us. The other story I thought about when I thought about putting bits into the mouths of horses, my daughter Isabella has had numerous horses over the years, and so it's funny. I mean, every horse has a different personality. Isn't that true? Yes, she's nodding her head. Yes, that's true. And so, you know, we had a couple of really easygoing horses, and really, they were just easy. You'd walk up to them. They liked you. They were great horses. And then one day we got Lucy. And Lucy was crazy. I mean, this horse was just, and she was the smallest of all the horses. All the other horses towered above her. But Lucy thought she was 10 feet taller than every other horse. And, you know, she just had a mind of her own. She would just, you know, I learned very quickly that you don't stand next to a stable door when Lucy's around, because the moment you weren't looking, you know, you would be crushed into the stable door as she ran through. She had no respect for me at all. And, you know, I thought, look, I am a man. I am the master. I'm going to load this horse into this little trailer we had. And so, you know, ready to take her in, I thought, she's a little horse. Now, what can happen? And the next thing I know, I'm off the ground, hanging on the halter. I'm banging around, you know, and everyone, of course, has given me instructions on how to load this horse. None of them helping me, but just watching me being led and banged around. And so, needless to say, this was one crazy little horse, and but like every horse, you put a bit in the mouth of a horse, and all of a sudden, they're quite obedient. And it was interesting, kind of twofold. One is, I still never rode the horse. I can only say this, you know, I'm living vicariously. Once Isabella put the bit in the horse, she could ride the horse quite well. But I say that because there's kind of two things that are happening there, is that, you know, in the same way that that we allow the Holy Spirit to move in our lives. It's like that bit. We're allowing the Lord to put a bit in our mouth, literally, you know, allowing Him to control what we're saying, what we're thinking, what we're doing. And, you know, from the horse's standpoint, it's interesting because it almost brought like peace to her. When she was free to do anything you want, she was crazy, but put a bit in her mouth, and all of a sudden she's like, yes. Would you like to go left? Okay, I'll go left. Would you like to go right? I'll go right. So it was both comforting, and I thought that so often in our lives, you know, when we're just making all our own decisions and saying we're going to go here, we're going to do this, you know, we live a life of chaos. But as we walk with the Lord and we say, Lord, I want that. Think of it as a bit in my mouth. I want you in my mouth controlling my speech, my thoughts, my actions. It brings a peace to us. We're no longer, we now have a master, you know, and isn't that the battle of the Christian life? You know, we're constantly battling. Those of you, again, that are old enough, remember the old four spiritual laws, and it had a picture of a throne, and it's like, who sits on the throne of your life? Is it you? Because if it's you, you're going to have a mess of a life. If it's Jesus, there's going to be order. There's going to be peace in your life. If it's you, sorrow. If it's Jesus, there'll be rejoicing. And I think that is what the life of a believer offers. It's like we think of it as, oh, Christianity, oh, it's a restriction on what I can do and don't do. It's not. It's life, you know? I've been watching these documentaries on people who are horribly addicted to drugs, and it's like all of them are so lost, and they really, you know, they just say, you just look at that and you say, they say, it's like, this is a horrible life, but I can't stop it. I can't get out of it. And they try everything, you know, to get out of it other than Jesus. You know, most of the documentary, I've never seen anybody say, I tried Jesus. But, you know, they try everything to get it, but they can't break that addiction. But they're so lost in their addiction that it's like there seems to be no hope. They just keep returning to the drugs over and over again. It's like, it's sad. I mean, I've watched several of these, and it just is really, I guess, created a heart of compassion in me for those that are struggling with addiction, because I think it's just all too easy to forget and just look over here and say, well, the people I know don't have this. And you can fill in the blank. They're not homeless. They're not addicted. They're not ill. You know, if we just try to not look at it. But that's not God's heart. I mean, who were the people Jesus first spoke about when he came into ministry? You know, he was talking about the poor. You know, he was talking about those who were down and under, people that the society that people didn't want to look at. That's exactly who Jesus, you know, came for. You know, he didn't come for the quote-unquote righteous. He came for those who had need. And Jesus said, you have need, I have hope. And, you know, your need will never, never exceed my abundance. I can always fill whatever your need is. I can fill that need. And I am more than able to do that. So that's the story of Lucy. I have many stories. If you'd like to hear horse stories, you can sit around the fire and listen to me tell horse stories of all the different things that have been pulled loose, as I'm not the greatest horseman in the world. So let's move to verse 5. It says, likewise, the tongue is a small part of the body, but it makes great boast. I think of that when I think of great boast. I think of boxers, you know, in the old boxing, they'd always stand there and they'd, you know, I'm going to hit you so hard, you're going to have to untie your shoe to see where you're going. And the other guy would, you know, he'd get up there and they'd all boast. You know, it was a boasting contest to, you know, who's the greatest? Who is the, you know, most worthy? You know, I can do this and I can do that. So let's look at over a chapter to verse 4. Let's see what the Lord has to say about boasting. Verse 4, verse 13. Good, comes up, great. It says, now listen, you who say, today or tomorrow we'll go to this or to that city, spend a year there, carry on business, make money. Why, you do not even know what will happen tomorrow. What is your life? You are a mist that appears for a little while and then vanishes. Instead, you ought to say, if it is the Lord's will, we will live and we will do this or that. As it is, you boast and brag. All such boasting is evil. How much boasting? All boasting is evil. Anyone then who knows the good he ought to do and doesn't do it sins. So what's God got to say about boasting? We're not to boast, are we? It's pretty plain. You know, I thought this was a weird scripture, just talk about how ignorant that I was in the scriptures as a new believer, but I had a friend who was actually a newer believer than I was, and I always thought it was strange because I'd say, hey, what are your plans? And he'd say, well, if the Lord wills, I'm thinking about, you know, finishing college. And I thought, well, what do you mean the Lord wills? You just go to college, you know? But he would say that over and over to me, and then later, you know, lo and behold, it's like, oh, he's quoting scripture to me, the guy that's been a Christian much longer than he has. But he was gracious, never said, you know, turn to James 4, dummy, and you know why I'm saying this. But he really did have that attitude, and he still does today. You know, I talked to him about something. It's like, hey, you want to go backpacking next summer or something? It's like, well, if the Lord wills, and he provides that opportunity, and you know, he sees it like that. It's as the Lord wills. If he gives me the opening, if he gives me the provision, great. And if he does it, that's great too. So boasting. The only positive boast a Christian can really have is boasting about what Jesus has done in your life. If you want to boast to someone, it's like, you know, I'm nothing. I am really nothing. But you know what? I'm everything because of what Jesus has done for me. And that's really the only boast we should be making, if we're going to boast, is that what the Lord has done through us. You know, because everything you have, you know, you hear about people saying, well, he pulled himself up by his bootstraps. He's a self-made man. Oh, really? Is he? You know, what did he really do? You know, he walked where the Lord allowed him to walk. You know, I know men that have worked very, very hard in their businesses and have not seen tremendous success. I know other men that have worked very hard and have seen it. You know, it's like Paul says, whether I'm abased, whether I'm lowly or abounding, whether I'm high, I give God praise. You know, it's God who does it. And we're just to be obedient wherever God has put us. You know, if God's put you in a church and you're thinking, I don't know if this is really the right church to be in. It's like, well, has God put you here? Has God released you to go anywhere else? Is God giving you grace to be here? Then just do, you know, work the row that God has given you until God gives you another row to hoe. I was very blessed as a young man, right after we were married, see how many stories I can tell. We got married. We decided, Kathy came from a charismatic kind of Assembly of God background. I came from a Baptist background. So we were living in this little neighborhood, and there was a Lutheran church real close to our house. So we thought, let's try that. Well, this church was kind of funny because it was traditional Lutheran in the early service, and it was sort of more of a mixture of a charismatic, if you're familiar with a vineyard, kind of a vineyard charismatic in the afternoon. So anyway, for us, it worked because it kind of gave me a little bit of a exposure to the Holy Spirit, and without me running out the door afraid. And, you know, it had enough of the Holy Spirit that Kathy, you know, could worship and enjoy it, you know. So it was a good mixture to start. And all that to say, very quickly we started co-leading the youth group. And my sweet pastor took me out to breakfast every week in the morning before work and would just pour it into me. And if you've ever had a brother or a pastor or a father pour into you, it's a precious experience. He was a seasoned man of God who just loved me, you know, and just taught me ministry, taught me, you know, the right off the bat. If you've ever been in church leadership more than 5 minutes, I don't mean to shock you, but we do have our problems in church. You know, and if you stay 6 minutes, you'll begin to experience that we're not perfect people. We're not perfect leaders. And, you know, we're in the church, it was struggling. There was a fight between, you know, the traditionalists that said, no, this is what a Lutheran is, and the other ones that said, no, this is just what Jesus said. So there was struggle, but he walked me through that for several years. But he used to say, you know, he used to say, go from, your ministry for your life should be from glory to glory. You know, you should go from a place where you're walking with God's hand on you, and if you move somewhere else, you know, you want to move where God's sending you. It's like the Israelites walking, you know, they had that cloud by day and fire by night. What happened if they moved out of that? They were picked off, you know, they were unprotected. But if you walk where God is walking, if you're walking where God is sending you, you're being faithful and obedient where he's planted you, you've got protection, you know, and you can go from glory to glory to glory. Well, does that mean you never have a setback? Of course not. But as I said earlier, you're walking, you're looking, like I'm looking at this big picture of Jesus back here. You're looking at Jesus. You're looking at perfection. You're saying, God, help me to keep my blinders on. Help me to keep focused on you so that you empower me to do your kingdom purposes here on earth. So let's move on to verse 6. Tongue is like a fire, it says. Verse 6. The tongue is also a fire, a world of evil among the parts of the body. It corrupts the whole person, sets the course of his life on fire, and itself set on fire by hell. I went to Yellowstone years ago, and Yellowstone experienced a huge, huge fire. It was amazing. I'd been to Yellowstone before the fire, and we went to Yellowstone after the fire, and it was thousands and thousands of acres of just torched land. And, you know, you read a verse about, you know, the fire being destructive and you know, he's equating it almost, you know, it's equating with fire. I mean, we think of hell as the fires of hell. It's a bad place. It's a place of torture. Well, this land looked like it had been tortured. It was just torched. One of the things I thought was really interesting in equating this to the tongue was that we went to the visitor center, we were watching a movie, and the fire is burning several miles away. And if you've ever been to Yellowstone, there's Old Faithful. It's a huge meadow. There's a lot of lodgings around there. But as the camera kind of pans over, so, you know, it's got some documentary voice. And over here, you know, they're talking about the fire. And as they're panning the camera, you see this wind come across this meadow. And it was amazing. It came with great force. And you just see, you can't see any fire, but you see the grass just go wah, like that and just gets smashed to the ground. And I was thinking back about that. That's like the tongue. The tongue, before, you know, if you're a person whose tongue is like the first part of the message or the first part of my title is a tongue of fire, if you have a tongue of fire, you know people who are tongues of fire, they don't even have to say anything and you already feel the heat. You know, they walk in the room and you're like, oh, this is gonna hurt, you know? Or they walk in the room and you're looking for the door because there are people, I mean, there are just people in this world that walk with a tongue of fire. You know, they're critical. They're never happy. They're always blaming somebody for something. And it's like, Lord, help me. I don't want to be that. You know, I don't want to be that person that brings a cloud of judgment, a cloud of, you know, that crooked finger that's saying, oh, you, and you're all wrong. You know, that's the tongue of fire. That's the tongue of fire we don't want to represent as Christians. On the same token, I think we all know people who have tongues of blessing. You know, you see them and you're just like, oh, this is going to be good. You know, we're going to sit down. We're going to talk about the Lord. We're going to talk about, you know, you just know that person. Even if they're in the midst of something difficult, they're going to be thankful. They're going to be praising God. You look at them sometimes and go, how can you be praising God? Your life's terrible. You know, and they're like, praise God, you know, praise God. He is walking me through this. I don't care what the situation is. I know I'm not alone. So it doesn't matter. And, you know, I was listening to Pastor Jack Avelin, Calvary pastor down south today. And I don't even know where he was in scripture exactly. It was 5 minutes on my way through a drive-thru. But he was quoting that scripture about how God set eternity in our hearts. You know, our whole being, our whole life is we yearn for a relationship with God. You know, we want to be that tongue of blessing because we want to reflect God. We have eternity, each of us. You know, each of us gets to decide where we'll spend eternity. But while we're on this earth, those of us who choose the Lord have the opportunity to express who God is to others. And that, I think that drives us. You know, I think that's why, you know, even when we struggle, it's like the Holy Spirit is in us And we still want to get to church. We still want to pray. We still want to listen to worship music. And sometimes it's just a matter of discipline. Sometimes it's just like, God, I am so down. You know, it's like, well, look in my word. Oh, Lord, okay. You know, and you begin to get in his word. And you're like, that's right, God. That's who you say I am. That's who you are. And that's the truth. You know, every day we're bombarded with the lies of the enemy. You're this. You're not that. And God says, no. You're my perfect creation, Don. You know, I love you. You know, I love you and I love you, you know, and I have a plan for you. And I will empower you. If you trust me and you're obedient, I will empower you to do the things that I've called you to do. And I'm reading a book right now. It's just like asking, what's your passion? You know, what is it that God's put in you? And then run with it, you know, run with it. Take what God's put in you, because each of us has been uniquely made. You know, Scripture tells us we're fearfully and wonderfully made. It's amazing. I'm different from Dan. I'm different from Joe. Each of us have gifting, but each of us have the opportunity to use that gifting. But we all get to decide, what do we do with it? You know, do we, you know, used to be a song, a Christian song. It's like they got to heaven and there's all these boxes. And it's like, what are all those boxes? Well, those are all the boxes Jesus gave people, but they never opened. And they were full of giftings, you know, and I think that would be very sorrowful. You know, God gave, you know, you gave somebody a present and then, you know, you're on their deathbed and you're like, they like, yeah, I never got anything in my life. And you're like, well, how about that box I gave you of all those, you know, diamonds and whatever's in the box? Well, I never opened it. It's like, what a sad, you know, what a sad thing when we have the opportunity to access the thing of God. Okay. Let's move to 7. All kinds of animals. Verse 7. All kinds of animals, birds, reptiles, and creatures of the sea are being tamed and have been tamed by man, but no man can tame the tongue. It is a restless evil full of deadly poison. Proverbs 18:21, that pops up there, says the tongue has the power of life and death. Tongue has the power of life and death. You know, animals don't struggle with gossip. You know, we sure do. Animals don't, you know, they don't struggle with judgment and critical hearts, but we do. And, you know, the scripture says no man can tame the tongue. And it's not leaving us in a place of helplessness. It's speaking reality. You know what? You'll never get a hold of your tongue until you give it to me. Until you give it to me, you're still going to be saying things that you don't want to say, or either saying things you shouldn't say, you know, believing things you shouldn't believe. No man can do it, but I can. I am the Redeemer. There's hope in me, and the Lord offers it to us daily. Verse 9, with the tongue we praise our Lord and Father, and with it we curse men who have been made in God's likeness. Another scripture that relates to that comes out of Psalm. It says Psalm 78:36. It says, never, I'm going to read my version, sorry. They remember that God was their rock, that God was the Most High, was their Redeemer, but then they would flatter him with their mouths, lying to him with their tongues. You know, that's unfortunately our walk sometimes. We tell God, you know, outwardly, or we sure look good in church. You know, oh, isn't he holy? Isn't he great? You know, and we kind of make these gestures, but yet, what's our life when we get back home? How are we treating our wives? How are we treating our children? How are we treating our relatives and friends and family? Are we being consistent, you know? And I think that's a real eye opener. You know, am I consistent? You know, if you meet me outside of here, and you know, you see me doing something I shouldn't be doing, that would be sad. You know, I mean, it was like, wow, this guy, he talks a good talk, but you know, he doesn't walk it. You know, we want to make sure. You know, just like the scripture says, let your yes be yes and your no be no. It's like, God wants us to obey him and to be consistent and let our lives be a reflection of him, whether it's here or anywhere else. And as Pastor Greg joked, if you can be a Christian and have young children and make it to a church on Sunday without sinning, you're doing good. You're walking the walk. Young children, my children are angels, however. Isaiah 29:13. Another scripture talking about the tongue. It says, the Lord says, These people came near to me with their mouth and honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. You know, we want to be people who come near to God and our hearts are near him, not far from him. We want to, again, it's just another scripture about what is it that we're saying? What is it that we're, what are our thoughts? What are we taking those thoughts captive? Are we having victory in our lives? And, you know, there's hope that that is certainly possible. Verse 10, I'm gonna blast through the next couple here. Verse 10 says, out of the same mouth come praise and cursing. My brothers, this should not be. And I think that scripture verse right there is really what got me into James tonight, because it is a struggle sometimes. I just think, you know, and verse 11 talks about, you know, can both fresh water and salt water flow from the same spring? Well, we all know that's not true. You know, I mean, that's either you've got salt water. If you've got a fresh water, it's contaminated. It's not good for anything. You know, it just doesn't happen in the natural world. But yet, you know, there's always that struggle. I mean, why does Paul talk about the old man and the new man? Because there is that struggle. You know, there is that fight. But time and time again, it's like, I don't want to surrender. I want to be that new man. You know, I want God to empower me to be that new man. And when that old man comes up, it's like, no, Jesus, that's not who I am now in you. And that is a battle that we need to be aware of. You know, there is a spiritual battle that goes on for our lives every day. It's like, who's going to have lordship of your life today? You know, are you going to be taking that bit out and setting it over here and just trying to do it yourself today? Or are you going to say, Lord, you control my speech. You control my tongue. Holy Spirit, you empower me to do that. Is there hope? I guess... If I was going to wrap this up and say, is there hope? Absolutely. In Jesus, there is hope. Your tongue can be tamed. Philippians 4:13 is probably one of the most quoted scriptures for everything in your life. But it says, you know, I can do all things through Christ Jesus who strengthens me. You know, all things are possible when we allow the Lord to work through our lives. The moment we take our lives into our own hands, you take your lives into your own hands. you know, the moment that you try to take over your life and run it is the moment that you're off track. You know, the moment you say, Jesus, you can strengthen me to take care of my tongue. You know, whether it be conversations in your head or whether they're things that are coming out of your mouth, God can give you victory. And I think a lot of times people think about these scriptures about taming the tongue is, you know, well, I'm much better with profanity now. I don't use it very often. You know, so it's like, okay, well, that's good. That's a step. But we can curse in many ways other than just using profanity. We can curse man and God just by our attitudes and the ways that we relate to people. So, and a lot of times, you know, as believers, it's like, well, yeah, we've got mastery maybe over our outward body, but you know, our inward body, it's like, I was thinking this morning again, I was running this morning and I just thought, wow, Jesus, your standard is so much higher than mine. You know, it's like, well, I'm pretty good. I'm getting better mastery of my tongue. And I thought, what does Jesus say about adultery? You know, it's not, I don't have to be engaged in adultery to be an adulterer. You know, Jesus' standard is way up here when it comes to our tongue, when it comes to adultery, when it comes to lying, you know, fill in the blank. Jesus, you know, it's like, well, I don't really gossip. Oh, but have you gossiped in your mind? Oh, yeah, I'm guilty of that. I need a savior again. You know, I need it again. Check. Need savior. Check. Need savior. So let's look at some other scriptures as we close about is there hope. Romans 8:37 says, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. You know, being a conqueror is pretty good. Being a conqueror is pretty great. You know, I've conquered something. Scripture here is promising us we're more than conquerors. You know, with Jesus, it's like he says, greater things than these, you know, my people are going to do. Greater things. You look at the things that Jesus did, it's like, those are amazing things. You know, he walked on this earth. But, you know, greater has a lot of different connotations to it. You know, right here in this room, there's, I don't know, 50, 7,500 people. You know, we can do great things through Jesus who strengthens us. You know, each one of us have people that and lives that we can touch. You know, you each know different people than I know. You've each had different experiences than I've had, but you can touch people for Jesus Christ. And those are great. Those are great things. We have the opportunity, you know, coming up, VBS, to touch little kids' lives. I don't know about you, but, you know, I loved VBS as a kid. You know, I mean, I was in VBS. I learned the basics of faith in VBS. And, you know, I look back and it's like my little old Baptist church sowed into me things that I still, you know, am reap today, just things of the kingdom that little patient people, you know, you think, oh, it's just a craft about Noah, or it's just a little thing about making straw and hay that we did, made bricks, you know, to remember the Israelites' struggle. There are things that are sowing, and we have that opportunity with our tongue to either sow into people goodness or sow into people bitterness. You know, what are you going to do with it? Are you going to use the things God's given you in life to encourage people or to discourage people? I really pray God helps me to encourage, be an encourager. Another scripture, it says, 1 John 5:4, for everyone who has been born of God overcomes the world. And this is the victory that has overcome the world, even our faith. God has released faith in us to believe that we can be an overcomer, that we can have victory, you know. And if just in your mind right now, if you're thinking, I am struggling with this, just say, Jesus gives me the victory to overcome it. He is powerful. My wife has had this thing the Lord has put on her for several years, you know, and you know, I won't say I'm Eeyore, but you know, we're pretty good friends sometimes. And as Eeyore, you know, I'm kind of always, you know, my cup's not always half full. It's half empty sometimes. And my wife will just look at me and say, she'll say, is Jesus enough? And you know, in good conscience, I can't disagree. It's like, yes, Jesus is enough. You know, but it just gets me back on track again when I think, Jesus is enough. You're right. Okay, I go forward, I take another step. You know, and so much of my walk with the Lord has just been taking the next step. You know, sometimes it's just like, it doesn't make sense, but Lord, I trust you, I'm gonna take another, not too many steps or I'll be out with you, but I'm gonna take another step. You know, I'm just gonna be obedient, I'm gonna follow you today. I don't know what tomorrow may bring, but I'm gonna follow you today. I'm gonna trust you because Lord God, I know you are enough. And that's comforting, and that brings us hope. Jesus is enough, whether it be your tongue or anything else. And I think I'm just going to close there and just say, if you're struggling with an area of your life tonight and you want prayer, I'd be more than happy to pray with you, and there'll be others that can pray with you. If you're struggling, you want victory, you want to say, I want to be that overcomer, please come and get prayer, and I'm just going to close in prayer, and then we'll finish up. Lord God, I thank you for your word. I thank you for the hope that you promise us, Lord. Hope of deliverance, hope of a life with you that makes sense, God. Nothing else in life makes sense until we get to that point where we see, Lord God, that you are sovereign, that you sit on the throne, Lord. Help us. Help us, Lord, to put you on the throne of our lives, Lord. Help us to look to you to give us direction and empower us, God, with your Spirit. Holy Spirit, we love you. We thank you for the work that you're doing. We thank you for the work that you've done, Lord, in bringing us here this evening. We ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.